mindset changes which the doctor, the team, and the patient needs to go through before we start on the journey. I will be mentioning a lot of changes and incorporations which we've done in our practice. I'll just touch them briefly in case the audience wants any more detailed information of all the practices which I have adopted in my center. Feel free to mail us at info@sharpside.in. I'll again repeat it at the end of the session. We'll mail you the complete brochure of how we are practicing, how a small practice, a middle practice, and a large practice will go. Okay, now all this is possible not because of me. I am just the face of this beautiful organization, this fantastic team I have. I'm just the face of it. They are the ones who do the work, and I'm just the loudspeaker here. So, first of all, victorious warriors win their wars in their mind. We as surgeons have to first of all win this war in our head that COVID is over. Even if it is not, we need to start telling ourselves that it is over. Only then we will be able to shake ourselves out of that slumber and come out of that fear. I just have a very small, beautiful video. I want the audience to...
output. So I've already got my Facebook information in here.
Can you see the video?
Yes.
Voices.
I just start from this.
Right. And here is my second destination. So you can see here, we can actually just put the information there. They've actually got YouTube Live already keyed in. So all you can actually get your custom RTMP information for each event. But for from both Facebook and from P information, then you can start streaming both to YouTube and Facebook at the same time. So that's a professional way to do it. Facebook and YouTube at the same time. So just to quickly recap, I'm going to go over just a few quick things here. One is obviously live streaming on Facebook. That's what we're going to show in this video. There's this new video tab where you can get that. And once you have that information, then you can start streaming both to YouTube. And the other way is you can do an RTMP. The difference is that it's, you know, always the same different key. My desktop key. Skipped all of the how to get here, and you basically get your RTMP information and your stream key. Now,
so
and
I
that
guess,
this RTMP
is loud and,
and then in the events tab, you can actually get your custom RTMP
now,
information.
The worst will be over
for each event.
When we
but
start
for this,
telling
we're
going to
show live streaming now.
The worst is going to be over. So when we win this war in our head,
so what you would do is you would copy this information from both Facebook.
All we need to do is follow the protocols which are being set by our AIOS and whatever adapt to best to us. And as again repeating here, it is not the strongest in the species which survives. It is the most adaptable. So as I would just repeat again, there is a change in the practice scenario. There is a paradigm shift. And only people who adapt fast to this change will survive. And if we have to adapt to this change, it has to be fast. Now, for the teams and our patients, all we need to tell them is, all is well. We will take care of you. We will follow all the protocols and everything will slowly fall in line. Now, how do we plan at Sharpside what we've done to plan to win this war? We cannot, as I said, win the war if the war is not won in our mind. So first of all is we need to win in our mind. We have to believe in ourselves that, yes, we and our team will together be able to fight this crisis of lockdown, post-lockdown, reduce patient inflows, extra protocols, extra stress on the system. We will be able to go there. Next is you have to win over our own team. We need to set protocols and processes which make sure our team realizes that whatever we are doing is for their safety and their care is of our prime importance. And most important is we need to lead from the front. I can't be sitting at home and wanting my doctors and my team to be running the show, whereas I want to be in the safety of my own cocoon. So we have to be out there in front with the team and doing the clinics and OPDs and surgeries. Then third is winning the enemy. The enemy here is the corona. How do we win it? By putting strict protocols and systems in place in our clinics, which make sure that the rate of infectivity and we are not cross-infecting people. And the most important is that also the war being won and the war being fought to be seen by the patients, it should be there in the public space. Let the patients know how hard you're working to keep their workspace, our work-safe space. The moment these four wars are won, we will see our practice starts bouncing back. So how do we do it? We regularly share these messages on our platform with our patients saying, look at the way India's done. You know, it has taken 110 days for 1 lakh cases to get collected, whereas compared to the world. Number of active cases.
Presenting,
these slides are shared with our own team members on a daily basis.
With me,
we share it with our patients
on WhatsApp Dr. Kumar
groups.
Doctor,
just to tell them that we in India are doing far better.
As well.
Let them
we will
not
be,
get scared by
we,
the way
we would
media
like to welcome you to this interesting
so
international
objective?
Webinar
First
where we have some of the topmost experts from across the world here to share what they will be, how they are doing things differently in cataract surgery over the last few months, and they are all leaders in their own fields, and we have an amazing...
to revamp the systems and processes so that we get back to the shape. Now, protocols, what are the major areas of protocols we have set? First of all is the appointment systems. What have we done in the appointment systems? What should we do in the appointment system so that we bounce back fast without extra load on the system and without causing much trouble to the system or the patients? Then is team alignment and training. Then reception and registration process systems. Then OPD protocols and management of OPD in patients, OT protocols, and then patient awareness and education and reassurance programs. Once I will be touching all of them briefly, but as I said, if you want more details, we'll be happy to give you details on the mail. Now, teams work and makes the dreams work. You could have an excellent team, but if they're not aligned to the goal and the objectivity, this is what you would land with. So we have regular scheduled meetings with the team, alignment, telling them what is the objective of this particular exercise we are doing, why should we do it, what would be the end product, and we take feedbacks from them. And if you say, sir, this is not working, this is wasting time, we go back to the drawing board and do that. Now, HR, human resource safety, is the important, most important step as me as a leader or as a team leader in the group. It rides on discipline. There has to be a perfect discipline. Make sure that everybody understands the protocols you have set and the reason why they're there. So basic few protocols is we asked all of the staff to have an Arogya Setu, you know, installed app in their phones. We tell them that, you know, if they're not feeling well, they need not come to the office. They need to inform the HR. There are some people who are not able to get transport. We are providing them pickup and drop facilities in the hospital ambulances. We are issuing ID passes so that the police doesn't stop them. We are doing repeated drills in the spare time when there are no patients so that they are ingrained, totally ingrained in the system of how to see patients. Public transport is to be avoided. These are instructions to the staff. Sanitization of the hands the moment they get off. They are all given disposable sanitizers with them. They get off the bus, they sanitize their hands. They enter the hospital, they sanitize mobile phones with alcohol spray, their mobile phones, their keys. If they are We are encouraging them to use Paytm or other resources and avoid cash payments just because of being infected. They are supposed to keep their lunchbox, handbags in lockers or in one designated place so that they don't get it into the whole organization. Personal belongings are kept at the reception. At lunch break, normally they would take lunch breaks together. I have a team of around, say, 25 optometrists. So they would probably want to go in lunch breaks of 10 batches. We are discouraging them. We are asking them to take breaks in lunch, sit separately. We are asking them to get their own disposable glasses and plates and water bottles. Though the water is available, we are ushering them to wear full sleeve clothes. Patient flow management, according to the patient flow management and the appointments which we have, we are actually positioning their duties and number of staff required. One great thing which we've done is we are encouraging patient only to come with appointment. Anybody who's coming without appointment would be asked to wait. So we are sending out SMSs to patients that take an appointment and come. Your waiting will be the least. And if you come in without appointment, you will have more waiting. Now, patient-related communication, this is a beautiful video. So what we have been doing during the lockdown, we've been sending these videos to patients to just be in connect with them. And in these videos, we are not talking about eye care and what we do and what we are good at. We are talking about compassion, what they should be doing in their lockdown period. how they should be taking care of their health, what are the kind of things they should be doing. And this is not just one video. We have numerous series of videos which were actually sent to these patients.
And what you,
and we are also telling that we are available
up
on
your desktop capture
for consultation without any charge.
And you would
so
pull up your streaming information.
Even during
I'm
the
using...
lockdown period, we are not losing a contact with our patients. They feel that here is an organization which is still bothered about us. We are sharing recipes of food. We are talking about singing classes, music portals, recommending movies on these portals so that the patients, even during the lockdown, is connected with us. When we send an SMS, we are telling the patient to get a mask for themselves. We are telling them to avoid bringing children. At the entry, they are asked to fill forms, COVID-19 consent form. So just in the SMS, they are priorly informed that these things will be done. So when they come, it is not as a shocker to them. So what it does for me is it creates a chain of professional approach to the patient. The patient knows that he's going to an organization which is bothered about his safety and the team's safety. So these are sharing recipes of food. So we made a waiting line outside the hospital premises in the parking where the patient comes, fills the COVID form, he's sanitized, temperature checked. And then after that, he enters the main gate where he's welcomed by people, form is collection. Again, the questions are asked again in repetition. And then his hands are sanitized and then he's let inside the organization. In the organization, again, if you notice, we keep a distance between the reception and the patient waiting. The patient again deposits a form and then he goes to a waiting area. In the waiting area, we maintain a space between each patient and the patient goes to the optometrist. We see the optometrist maintains an adequate distance recommended and has all questionnaires and all questions asked to the patient. Then the patient goes to the doctor waiting room. This is how we are maintaining the sanitization. Every 3 hours, we do one sanitization of one floor, give 20-30 minutes of soak time, and then the patients are let into that floor. We are cleaning the slit lamps, all with 70% alcohol, the slit lamps and all the surfaces where the doctor is sitting or the patient is sitting. Before the patient enters the optom room, he's again urged to do sanitization of his hands. He's made sure that he has a mask. In case he doesn't have a mask, he's given a mask free of cost, a three-layer mask to the patient, and then he's let in. And every few 45 minutes, patient sees intense scrubbing and sanitization exercise in the premises. Now, what this has done for my organization is, patient goes back knowing that if I come to this place, this is one place at least from where I will not get infected because the organization is very much concerned about their own safety and my safety. So what it is doing for us is it is letting the patient now call up to take appointments because the word is spreading that yes, Sharpsight is doing an excellent work at making protocols and making sure that the protocols are doing. These are the patients who will, these people will handle the files. We are not even handling the files manually. The papers are taken into the own pink colored files. And then these files are handled. We don't handle the paper ourselves. We have a complete digital platform with an EMR. In the pre-op room, there is a spacing between each patient. And as I said, now fans in the OPD, what do? We are trying to discourage use of air conditioners, keeping all the doors open. So this will reduce the fomites transmission. Patient is washing his hands. Doctor is scrubbing his hands after each wash. We have put signboards that avoid lifts. Only patients who are vulnerable should be avoiding using the lifts. In case there is a patient with redness and conjunctivitis, he's put straight to the red eye clinic where one doctor with a complete PPE is examining him and sending him out of the system immediately. There are no attendants allowed in the doctor's room or the optom's room until unless the patient is vulnerable or handicapped or is a little child. We put 0.5% sodium hypochlorite solution exposure every 15-20 minutes after a gap of 1 to 2 hours, depending on the load in that room. Reception, as I said, will send the patient straight, red-eye patients. Now, beautiful thing is, while the patients are waiting in the waiting room, they are not left alone. We have educational videos running in the waiting rooms. We have our PCTs, which are patient caretakers, young boys and girls who are trained. They keep giving the drill of sanitization at home, sanitization in the clinic. They keep repeating these things to the patients. So while the patients are waiting, because the waiting times are longer than normal now, they are very busy. They get to learn a lot of hand hygiene, food cleaning, going to the market. So these RTM people keep educating them either on a television or something. Now, these are the kind of videos which are running in the waiting room, both Hindi and English. Now, these are interesting videos. They are not very long, 20-20 seconds clip on different topics. No, next time a patient comes, he remembers these protocols. He remembers to get his own mask. He remembers that, you know, he has to do these things. So while he's seeing that, all the other patients also seeing these notices are realizing that this organization takes this safety very seriously. Now, once this is done, we've also started a social media campaign telling the patient. Now, if you see, it says, "Fir se shuru kijiye, ek nayi shuruaat," which are trying to tell the people that, yes, this is an organization maintaining on protocols and everything is good and we are taking good care of yourself. We are not wanting to dilate the patients there in case a patient needs a dilatation. As SMS is sent with the dosage and the patient comes with one drop instead. 70% alcohol spray for all instruments which are to be touched by the doctor each time he keeps it back. Documents are to be avoided to be touched. I'm just going fast because these things are available in a document in case you request us at the email address info@sharpsight.in. We'll mail you the complete protocol for all kinds of practices. Infomercials. Now, the golden dictum is for all the staff. Everything is contaminated until clean in front of your own eyes. So if the doctor wants to touch something and he has not seen it being clean, it has to be clean before he touches it. The same goes for the whole staff. Slit lamps, OCT, angiography, trial frames, everything is clean after the patient walks out. So what we do is we give a gap of 4 minutes after one consultation and before the next patient walks in, there's a gap of 4 minutes when the whole area is scrubbed and the patient is given a complete clean area. Now, very important part is the financial jugglery. We are also crashed on our finances. So these are a few tips. If we have a personal relationship with the vendors, we can give part payments. We have to ensure while we are looking at less revenues, we also have to look at, is there any recovery due from the government panels or TPAs? We need to put teams on that to recover that. We have to talk to companies to defer CMCs and EMIs to the banks. The staff, we are at SharpSight have not offlaid even one of our staff till now. The promise we made to the staff is we will not lay off anybody, but what we are doing is staffs which are not used being used. Let us say the marketing people are sitting inside the clinic. So they're helping with the COVID protocol. They're helping help the patient, explain the protocols, clean the places. So everybody is utilized back into the system. Advertising budget has been totally cut off because there's no use advertising right now. We are offering EMI options and bank EMI options to patients who want surgery, but they are short on cash. Social media is an effective, cost-effective method. Salary structure, we've offered salary bump downs to our doctors, to our staffs, except to the basic lower staff. We are also offering food and daily requirements for the very low staff and peons, offering them flour, atta, dal, sugar, oil to take care of this part. We're doing cost cutting, whichever floor is not being used, ACs are not being switched on. So I'll just jump fast. Now coming to the OT protocols. All surgeons in my practice, this is what we are doing. We are wearing double 95 mask and a three-layered mask on top, impermeable gown and a cotton gown beneath that, complete shoe cover and cap, protective eye shield. But if the surgeon is not comfortable wearing a protective eye shield during a microscope, he's given a choice. We have UV lights between surgical breaks. Patient walks in wearing a sterile gown always. And the patient also has a shoe cover, a cap and a new set of three-layer masks handed outside the theater. Povidone iodine, fumigation regularly, and air conditioning in the OT complex is only prior to the surgery or in between then the breaks and autoclaving is happening. We have inlet at the air circulation at the HEPA filters. We put UV lights. This is how we take care of that. These are the few investigations we are going through. We are not asking for COVID tests. These are the investigations we are going for. And I think my presentation is nearly over. So I'll say, manzil mil hi jayegi, batakte hue hi sahi. Manzil mil hi jayegi, bhatakte hue hi sahi, gumrah to wo honge jo ghar se nikle hi nahi. So let us, friends, all start our practices and start on the journey and getting it, everything kicked back. So in a bend in the road is not an end of the road. Unless you fail to make a turn, it is going to be an end of the road. Thank you. So over to you, Siddharth. I guess now Dr. Piyush Kapoor.
Yes, sir. I say that Dr. Kamal has very beautifully presented that how to make a new start in this COVID era.
So in the, a bend
but
in the
just
road,
to add on, I would say, yes, you need to be courageous. But courageous has to be with a proper sense, a proper intelligence governing your
heart and your mind together. It is a time to be so actually you, very careful with what we are doing. Our protocols have to be in the right place. Our protocols have to be practical. What he said, like, we have to screen our patients very carefully before they enter the premises, and we have to sanitize them properly. The messages have to be given. But one thing where with Dr. Kamal, I won't agree is that in my organization, what I'm looking forward for is that my patient waiting time is, I am promising that is reduced to just half an hour. We are actually sending back the patients if we see that the flow inside the cabins is a little too much, rather than they sitting in the waiting area. And, you know, I would say that in spite of all the precautions and everything, the staff being educated to the maximum, still I would like the minimum exposure of the patient as well as my staff to the patients to prevent any kind of a cross-infection. So what we are looking forward in our organization is that we are reducing our waiting time just to about half an hour, and we are actually not allowing too much of a rush inside the reception, inside the waiting chamber. Rest, I would say, Dr. Kamal has beautifully highlighted, and as always, he is a very sharp brain to set the protocols. And thank you, Dr. Kamal, to offer your protocols to the entire society. And going further, I would request Dr. Jaya to introduce the next speaker so that we can take the next topic ahead.
Okay, so I think our next speaker is Dr. Kumar, and his talk is about bringing back cataract and refractive surgery. So a few words about Dr. Kumar, He's basically the CEO of Dr. Eye Institute, Mumbai. He has been the president of Indian IARSI 2013 to 2014. His specialty, he specializes in cataract and refractive surgery. He's a member of ASCRS, ESCRS, AIOS, Maharashtra Ophthalmic Society, and POA, including AIOS, and has held post as member of scientific committee in AIOS for 6 years. He's received several awards, the best paper award at ASCRS, best video award at AAO, also the Daljeet Singh Gold Medal Award by the then Chief Minister of Maharashtra, Sri Vilasrao Deshmukh. So over to you, Dr. Kumar, for your presentation, Bringing Back Cataract and Refractive Surgery.
So, at the onset, I would like to thank Siddharth, Kamal, to have given this opportunity to me. I have known Siddharth, I think, for more than 15 years now, a long journey together, and thank you once again. So, I think what Kamal said was fantastic. I learned a lot from him. He's covered most of the points, but I'm going to tell you from my side, what extra are we doing or what different are we doing. Now, the tricky part here is going to go into cataract surgery and refractive surgery. I would like to thank Dr. Bhavin and Dr. Ankita to have helped me with this presentation. So here the question is to identify the challenges, diverse in strategy, and then to attack and improvise. So we'll have to take each step at a time, and how do we go around it? So what are our challenges? Right now, our biggest challenge is reduction in routine OPD patients. There's a decrease in demand for elective cataract and refractive surgery. There's a risk of transmission, as already mentioned by Kamal, and there's a need to change the challenge. Need to change to adapt to new conditions. So now let's take one thing at a time. So here the challenge is surgeon factor, patient factor, and hospital staff factor. So we are not going to take each thing at a time. Now surgeon factor, there was a study done all over, and it was published and also done by AIOS. And I was shocked to hear that there is a huge suicidal tendency in our ophthalmologists. And there was a certain percentage out of this 3.12, a certain percentage had daily, and some of them had twice a week, and some of them had once a week suicidal tendencies. So it's psychologically affecting our colleagues. This is not imaginary, because the survey was done by AIOS and it was published by AIOS. So we know about it. Now, as far as surgeon factors are concerned, an object that is a surgeon at rest continues to be at rest. So that's inertia, and this is Newton's first law of motion. So the question here is, we all get a little lethargic. In fact, I was telling somebody the other day, I've started now going to work since the 7th of May. I was not working in April. We went only 6 days. And now the question here is, I've started going and I'm only working 10 to 2, so 4 hours a day, and then coming back home. Now, do you want me to start working 12 hours after 1st of June? The question is a big question, because I've started enjoying this kind of life. But yes, there is a factor. The main fear here is health workers across the world and the country have been affected. 548 doctors, nurses and paramedics have got infected with COVID. This is the data of 6th of May 2020. So there's a huge fear and apprehension amongst our doctors itself. And recently, I believe many doctors and paramedical staff in AIIMS also got infected. Now, how to solve these problems of surgical factor? One is to make sure that the knowledge and the skill, that is through webinars and online courses, is well spread amongst ourselves and colleagues. Talk to seniors and try to remember that since we are all in the same boat, what are the additional precautions we can take? Prepare yourself mentally and slow revival of practice that's going to happen. So you have to have some hobby, spend some time in that and spend some time with your family. Take your professional help if needed. So this is what is necessary. Coming to patient factors, I think Kamal has covered it beautifully. But what am I going to say is the main fear that we are seeing in Mumbai is scared and fearful. Recently, and day before yesterday, I got a call from a 29-year-old person. Had a little abrasion in the eye, little subconjunctival hemorrhage. I saw a picture on WhatsApp. I told her that it's better you come and see. And all she replied was, sorry, doc, I cannot come. If I come out, I will get COVID and I will die. So this is the biggest fear that has become psychological in our patients. And all this is because of our television. So I'm not saying go out with us and nothing is going to happen. But it's really playing on the mind of our patients. And this is going to really find it tough. So like rightly mentioned by Kamal, that we are taking precautions in our hospitals to look after you. I think we also have to make sure that the patients get a message that it's not the end of the world. It's just a virus. I'm not saying it's a very common cold virus, but it is a virus. If you see statistics, ultimately, I think it'll be 0.5% mortality in this case. Now, coming to such a threat and by a small virus, people are so scared that they don't want to come out. In Bombay, we have a different issue. The biggest issue in Mumbai that we have is there's no transport. So we don't have rickshaws, we don't have taxis, we don't have trains, we don't have buses. So the only patients who can really reach our clinic, because we are still under a lockdown till the first, that is only by a private car. And so the ratio is very, very little. Till all of this doesn't really open up, I really don't know when is it going to open and what's really going to happen. Another issue that we are going to face is, since everybody is not working, everybody is less of their own economy, there's a low income, and so they don't want to spend on elective procedures immediately. So their category of elective procedures from a premium IOL may go down to a different IOL altogether. How do we address this each issue? It is hospital level, so we make sure that the hospital level is safe. We have to follow SOPs, which are guidelines made by our own organization. Procedure adequate, effective and certified PPEs that has to be given. Most important, I think, is to train your staff as to what exactly, how they have to wear the PPEs, social distancing, how they have to work, and the protocols they have to follow at the place of work all the time. Addressing patients' fear factors, as rightly mentioned, is that patients' education is very important. As well as you making a video, make sure that the video is circulated and goes to them as a link. And again, highlights the safety measures that are taken in your hospital. Prevent infection, that what care are we taking in the hospital, and beyond that, make sure that there's no spread internally that is happening at all the time. And this has to go out on all media channels that is possible. Teleconsultation as far as possible in small issues. You all know the ophthalmic limitations of teleconsultation and to ensure prior appointments. So without appointments, we are not taking in patients to prevent overcrowding. As it is, there are very few patients here, but this is what we are trying to follow. And minimum patient visits, so we call them again after a longer time. Adjust cleaning timings to suit. Now, right now, we are working only for 4 hours. Some doctors are working for 6 hours. It all depends. Video testimonials of the operated patients can be taken in the past, and that can be circulated to make sure that, yes, they have come in and they have been looked after. They are sure that all the measures taken in the hospital are being followed, and what is actually said on the YouTube channel is actually being done. Many times it so happens that we make a beautiful video, and when the patient arrives, your housekeeping staff is not there, it's not being followed, and again, they are going to be unhappy. As far as staff factors are concerned, we have a shortage again. We have issues in Mumbai because they cannot travel. So if a staff is staying very far, they don't have a modality, then the BST buses are very few that are really working. Today, in fact, some of my staff got stopped on the scooter by the police saying that it's not only an identity card, they also need a letter from the organization, and then only they'll be allowed to go. So it's problem in multifactorial, which is staff may be shortage. demotivation and fear because of the transfer of the virus. So we have had patients, our staff's parents question us that what happens if they get COVID at the time of work. So most important is keep staff motivated, ensure that they will be looked after. Staff training, so we have had demonstrations internally as to how they wear masks, how they wear the cap, how they change the mask. We make them wear a mask and every cap as soon as a face shield and a gown as well as gloves. And explaining each step to them at the organization is done at the step one. And once that is done, we organize the staff workflow, arrange the staff commute if possible, avoid laying off staff as much as possible. Up till now, we have not laid off anybody this time, and health insurance for staff if possible. OPD setup, of course, designed the consent form for staff. So we have taken consent from the staff, and we also have to take consent from the patient. That tomorrow, if the patient comes to you for an OPD, then goes back home and then gets fever after 5 days, can easily blame the hospital for having got COVID. So I think we need a special consent. This was said by the AIOS committee, and they have laid down these forms at the AIOS website. Consent forms has to be given to the patient when they walk in. We check the temperature. I'm just showing you a little video. So you can see that we have started. As soon as the patient comes here, what we do is take the temperature outside the same place. They go ahead, we give them a little bit of a hand wash. They take a signature of the consent. Once that is done, the patient comes in, and then we put a cross on everywhere where they can sit. So they will not touch the door at all. We put a cross on the floor, and that's where the patient will allow to sit. We do not allow relatives inside the setup. We have a sitting capacity of only 120 people. So no relatives are allowed inside. As soon as the patient goes, there is a mopping of the floor. There is bacillus sit put. And continuous, this happens throughout the day. Once the patient gets up, you can see that the same seat is being cleaned with bacillus sit. That happens continuous. And once that is done, even the autoref is cleaned at the same time before the patient, in front of the patient. Once the patient goes into the chair, we clean the chair again with the disinfectant. Once that is done, we go ahead and take the patient in. We make sure that the slit lamp is clean. Once the slit lamp is clean, the patient is taken in and indirect for whatever procedure has to be done. So this is followed between every patient. So obviously we have only a few number of appointments that are given throughout the day, and the care is taken throughout. So this is how the whole thing happens. Now, as far as the surgical setup is concerned, now this is going to be tricky. Can we do a COVID test and a chest X-ray before? Now, Maharashtra government has come out with a law that we cannot do a COVID test before surgery. And this was yes sometime back and no sometime now. So laws keep changing, instructions keep changing, depending on the availability of the test. But right now, we are not allowed to do COVID tests. And I was thinking of doing an X-ray chest, but again, that's a questionable thing. But as rightly mentioned by Kamal, I think we can do an X-ray chest, but COVID test is not allowed by us. A fantastic video has appeared about aerosols and cataract surgery. So I'm just going to show you about what precautions that they have advised. And this, all of you can see, only one thing I found in this setup was that this is a cornea put on an artificial chamber. I would have loved this if this test had been done on an actual eye. Okay, and what they have done is they have measured the aerosols. The flow of fecal emulsification and told what size should be the incision size. So one thing that is very clear, that the incision size has to be 2.2 millimeter and not 2.7. Okay, so some of us are taking a 2.8, then you can see this aerosol flying in the air. Two things that I missed in this video. One is they have not measured the height of this aerosol. If they would have measured this height, A, it would have been fantastic. Two, I would have preferred that if they had put methylene blue in the phaco, and that methylene blue will throw blue color out in the aerosol format. Okay? And this will actually stain your whole drape. So you can actually count how much area the aerosol is actually covering. So this is one more thought that I had. But the take-home message in this is very, very good. That you put one drop of methyl cellulose on the incision, and you'll be surprised that once you put methyl cellulose, the aerosols, this is the aerosol that you can see in continuous phaco, and you can see the phaco tip that's inside the anterior chamber. Put methyl cellulose, and the aerosol goes away. The effect of methyl cellulose lasts only for 1 minute. So I told my staff that you now start putting methyl cellulose on the incision every 40 seconds. And another important thing was about providone iodine, which we all are doing. So providone iodine has to be put in the eye, which we put in the eye. We clean the whole eye around it. And this helps it. So they said that if you use providone iodine of 0.25%, is good enough to kill. So 0.23% is good enough to kill 99.9% of the virus. So we all are using 5% povidone iodine. So all this is very, very good. And one more take-home message of this video was to do with, before you start phaco, it is important that you do irrigation aspiration in the eye to remove the viscoelastic for 6 seconds. Okay? So that removes all the virus load from the anterior chamber, if at all there is any. So this is what was meant. That the anterior chamber load is only 0.29%. So that is one more take-home message. So treat, I am personally of the opinion, treat every surgery, forget cataract, whether it's a retina, we've done some retinal detachment surgery and oil removal, etc. Treat the patient as a COVID. I think the take-home thing, what Kamal has said outside the OPD is brilliant. Keep a 20-minute gap between two cases. Make sure you're fast as soon as possible. Pre-op betadine is compulsory, which is proven by that video. Incision size becomes 2.2 if you are 2.7. And covering the incision with HPMC is compulsory every minute. I made it every 40 seconds. That is another important thing to be done. As far as LASIK goes, okay? Again, we used to use betadine outside, but now I've started putting one drop of betadine in the cul-de-sac. Procedure of smile is preferred over femto. Blade, they say the aerosols are more, so avoid blade surgery. They also say avoid surface treatment at the moment because of the plume. But the new lasers already have a plume remover, so we don't need to worry about that. As far as the drape in LASIK goes, make sure that the patient's fluid do not fall on the patient or on the doctor's foot or on the foot switch. So when we are washing, make sure that this fluid goes into the bag that collects all the fluid and make sure that they only use one swab per eye. And preferably we use a suction speculum. I'm using a suction speculum in LASIK, so the fluid is continuously drained out. And plume, I don't think really is an issue because we are burning the cornea. So as far as corona has changed the way we practice ophthalmology for the near future, yes, 100%. But eventually, I think we just go around it. So the word of mouth of the precautions that you are taking in your clinic will ensure that no other patient gets the disease. Visiting the clinic will help actually building up your OPD and surgical work. I don't know about discounts. Like Kamal said, to give discounts at this stage, I'm really not too sure whether we should give this EMIs and discounts and all that, because the cost, Kamal has not mentioned, actually the cost has gone up tremendously because now the amount of bacillol, bacillocin and sterilium, gloves, masks, gowns that you will be using per month has gone up so high, it's unbelievable. So the cost going down is impossible. So I don't think discounts should be offered. That's my personal opinion and I am not offering any. So the take-home message here is that staff, doctor and patient, you can see three hands here, all of them do have to work together. The staff, the patient and the doctor will work together and make sure. So ensure proper safety and protocols in your hospital and clinic. Consent for staff and patients should be taken. We have to build confidence and sense of security of each patient entering the clinic. Patients should feel safe that yes, they are looked after and that there are less chances or no chance that they will get the disease from the center that they have come to. And throughout patient counseling for safe, satisfying surgery is very, very essential. This is just a little video I got today, luckily, from Saurabh. It's unbelievable. This is a very early practice.
Bada pao haath aur chai pyalo mein hogi. Dadar virar fast local. Phir patri par bhagegi. Film city gore gaon ki. फिर सारी रात जागेगी शूटिंग वाली आवाज फिर कानों में होगी फिर इडली कॉफी साइकिल वाली दुकानों में होगी मलाड से जू जाने में 2 घंटे लग जाएंगे फिर भी प्ले देखने हम प्रश्न थिएटर आएंगे जू चौपाटी की पाव भाजी वैसे ही ऑर्डर करेंगे स्ट्रगल कर रहे साथी फिर बिल 4 जेब से भरेंगे पुणे स्टेशन घाटकोपर मेट्रो से फिर ऐसी आवाज आएगी आदर्श नगर में नागोरी चाय फिर वैसे ही पी जाएगी ऑटो वाले सीएनजी की फिर लंबी लाइन लगाएंगे गांधीवली चलोगे भैया हम फिर कह के मुस्कुराएंगे ओबरॉय इन्फिनिटी सारे मॉल फिर वैसे ही खुल जाएंगे फिर लोखंड वाला बैक रोड पे सब जॉगिंग करने आएंगे नाचते गाते फिर हम सब विसर्जन करने जाएंगे गणपति बप्पा मोरिया पूरी दुनिया से अलग इसकी अपनी शान है ये फिर दौड़ेगी फिर भागेगी ये मुंबई मेरी जान है
so bottom line is stay home stay safe thank you and have a great day just stop sharing. Yeah, over to you, Kuresh and Kamal.
Yeah. Please take some questions, Jaya.
So there's a question from Dr. Hardeep Singh. How to maintain distance between hospital staff in less space clinic?
I think you people in Delhi have no idea what is less space. But
I agree with you.
Yeah, in Mumbai, we know what is space and we value every inch that, you know, the clinics are sold per square inch, not per square foot or square yard as in Delhi. So, yes, it is a real problem. The whole thing is, do you need that many staff? If you're in a tiny clinic and you've got four receptionists sitting there because you could afford it at that time, and four receptionists crowded to see, here your patient load and flow is going to be less. Let, as Kamal correctly said, give them a roster of duties, rotation of duties. So instead of having four receptionists, I have only one receptionist sitting at a time. And the next week, the second one will come. The next week, the third one will come. Or 50% or 25%. So reduce the staff. See that your staff is moving around instead of sitting in one place. And I'm sure you can manage in the tiniest of clinics by reducing non-essential staff. Give them, retrain them, as Kamal correctly said. Give them other work to do. Some of his people who are engaged in something else are now doing something else in the clinic. So use only the minimum staff required.
I'd just like to add, sir, I think you said it beautifully, because I did get the opportunity to visit a few clinics in Mumbai. At that point, I realized that we in Delhi are blessed to have, you know, 15,000, 20,000 square feet clinic. So, but what I agree with you is that as it is, the work is not there. So why call all the staff? Just because the more staff you call, you'll be crowding them and you're putting more people at risk, you know, within inverted commas. So have a limited staff as required for the amount of appointments. So this is where the point which I said is very important. We should all move to an appointment-based practice. We at Sharpside were already at 68% appointments, and now we're practically moving to 90% appointment practice, which is at least telling me beforehand how much the patient load I expect tomorrow. So I can coordinate my staff, my optoms, my PCTs, my reception, my pharmacists, my optical counters. So everything can be done. You don't need to call everybody, as Dr. Kuria said, and I think that can be very well managed. Any questions, Jaya?
So what I will just add a point that you are absolutely right, Kamal and Kuresh. Both of you said the right thing. So what we have done is two clinics. So we have split the staff into 50-50. We are working only 4 hours a day. So technically, one staff will work only 1 week in a month. And they are rotated. So staff becomes less than half. They become almost quarter. And we are going purely by appointment. All practices are different. Like if you go to South India, Sri Ganesh gets 500 emails per day to answer as appointments, and we hardly get emails per day to give appointments. So Mumbai is still based on a system, I think Kuresh will agree with me, where they make a call to the clinic, take an appointment and then appear. So yeah, it's a very regional kind of a thing. And same way, we are facing a big problem here in Mumbai is a lockdown still being there. There is absolutely no transport. So the patients which are actually reaching the clinic are only those who have their own vehicle. Otherwise, they can't reach the clinic.
I would like to add one small point. There is another angle to this. I am working in Sir Gangaram Hospital. It is a multi-speciality hospital.
Yes.
So here we have 10 consultants. So every day they are calling only one consultant in the ophthalmology department. So it is divided. So 1 to 2 consultants. And why it is also important to alternate the staff is because just in case one team or one specific team gets COVID, he has to at least go quarantine for a few days. During those time period, if your whole staff has to go to quarantine, then it will not be possible to run your clinic. So always have some people in reserve, at least during these times. That is a very important factor. So if everybody gets COVID positive, then few days your clinic is gone, whatever you might try.
One very important take-home message for small clinics and clinics which are not maintaining a record. Okay, kindly maintain a record. So if that patient has come on Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, your clinic should know exactly which staff was on duty. So it can so happen that after 1 week, a patient gets COVID positive, they trace it back to your hospital. You should not struggle to find out that day on Monday, which staff was there, unka check karao. So best is your internal record should maintain very well which staff has come on that day on a day-to-day basis. So then there's no struggle. If there is an inquiry after 10 days, just say, okay, on that day, these people were present. Tell them to lay off, get their COVID test done, and then think ahead.
That's where digital attendance and digitalization and appointment system.
I think beautifully brought out, Kumar. We do that. We have a biometric attendance, and there are Excel sheets of people.
You should not struggle to find out
that day. Come on that day. So those Excel sheets are circulated on WhatsApp. So I think this is something very good.
On Monday, which staff was there? Who can check around? So best is your internal record should maintain very manner.
I think
what has to say because we are not permitting biometrics at the moment.
Exactly. I was going to say the same thing. The biometrics to be avoided.
Yeah, is actually a point of spread. So even if they clean their hand, it's not correct, according to me. So I'm actually not allowing biometrics at the moment in my clinic.
Same here.
Actually, we are doing biometric with a card system. We have cards also. They don't need to touch the machine. So correct. That's correct.
Consultation is a very, very important thing. Things can be sorted out
any family member COVID positive or any patient quarantined or any family member quarantined in your house also? If yes, because Delhi has a very clear cut system of having COVID hospital and non-COVID hospital. If you have any doubt before even patients coming to the clinic, you can always say, phone to our clinic if you are COVID positive or you are in under quarantine, go to another hospital. So general precautions has already been talked about. You have to check about the mask of the patient. The temperature must be taken outside the clinic. And the patient must sanitize his hands. Physically shown in the video by doctor. Coming to the examination of the retina. First, I am talking specifically about retina and visual retina. Direct ophthalmoscopy is a complete no. Even if you are wearing the mask or even if you are doing anything else, direct ophthalmoscopy, you are doing very, very close to the patient. So please avoid that because there are other better ways. You can do a under photograph, even your technique can become under photograph. This is not really 100% sufficient,
but for small pathologies like diabetic retinopathies or anything, you can pick it up. Slit lamp examination, 90D examination. You can see the photographs, how I am doing. I am doing an indirect ophthalmoscopy down here. Then I am taking a fundus photograph myself. And this slit lamp shield, you can see. I hope you can see. This is a slit lamp shield because we have to do lasers also through the slit lamp. We have to do an examination through the slit lamp, even a 90D examination. So slit lamp shield is also a very important thing that can prevent any direct droplets coming from the patient to you. And please don't talk to the patient while examining. Very important. If you are talking with the patient, you are doing a lot of error because patient, when we'll talk, he will have something out from his breath, and it is better to ask the history before, keep him seated little away from you, and that is what is should be followed. Indirect ophthalmoscopy, you can have a, like you can see, you can have a shield along the indirect ophthalmoscope, but I prefer to wear, you can see here, I have marked here, I prefer to wear these glasses. These are simple plastic glasses, and I have found it very, very convenient. They almost stick to your eye, and it is not difficult to perform IO through this. I'm sharing my own experience. I'm doing this since last 15-20 days, now more than that. Then what about OCT and angiography? So how do you keep the equipment clean? Keep the equipment clean, like already been said, with alcohol wipes. Change the gloves or sanitize after every exam. Patient should always be wearing a mask. You can see the patient is wearing a mask. Doctor, myself, I'm always wearing a double mask and I'm wearing gloves, and this OT linen gown is good enough. You don't have to be really scared. Nothing is going to penetrate through the gown and through your clothes. So I have the hospital clothes underneath this. I come and change in the hospital, wear the hospital gown, the gloves, and then a double mask, and my cap is always there. No relative should be allowed inside. And OCT angiography is preferred to floor scene angiography, which is a non-invasive procedure. And ICT is best avoided because, again, it is a lengthy procedure. During these times, lengthy procedures should be avoided. What do we do while doing laser? Non-contact method preferred. You can see this photograph. This is not my actual photograph, but you can see non-contact methods are always preferred because distance, it will help in maintaining the distance. Always have the patient wear the mask, and you also wear a mask, and avoid scleral depression. We tend to do a lot of scleral depression, but during these days, it will be wiser not to do depression. This can lead to the spread of the infection. And do not talk to the patient. Very, very important point, not to talk to the patient. That is a very important point. Precaution while doing laser, we should prefer a multi-spot laser because that is faster, lesser time. One point which nobody has really highlighted is the exposure time. I have read a lot of articles during the last few days preparing for this thing. They say that the exposure time is also very important. That is why we see why the restaurants are not opening up, why the cinema halls are not opening up. The contact time with the patient also matters. That is why a surgery that is to be done should be done in these days, at least not by people who are under training. The time period involved with the patient who is suffering, he may be an asymptomatic COVID patient. If you spend less time, there is less chance of the COVID infection coming on to you. And like described earlier, povidone iodine drops after procedure, even after laser procedures, we are putting this povidone iodine drops. They really don't hurt if you have already put in a local anesthetic. How do we clean the lenses? So lenses can be cleaned ideally with a soap and water, because doing them with any other solution like alcohol or sodium hypochlorite may harm these lenses. So have a soft sponge. Don't have a cloth also. Soft sponge is the best way to keep the lenses clean. Ideally, beforehand also, before this COVID started, these are the best recommendations. Don't clean them with a dry cloth. Don't clean them with distilled water, because that will lead to the shorter life of the lenses. And we don't want a short life of any instrument, things going so expensive these days. So clean one lens at a time and dry the lens with a low-lint cotton. And what we can do is, you can see the non-optical surface of the lens. If you want to be over-protective, either you have gloves in your hands or cling film over the non-optical surface, which can be changed after each patient. How to clean the slit lamp? All non-optical surfaces with alcohol spray. So you can see here, I've highlighted here, the headrest, the chin rest. It is important to clean them with alcohol after every patient, after every use. So all contact areas, very, very important, along with the handle which the patient keeps. And ideally, the spray should be done on the seat also where the patient is sitting. How to do with the V-scan probes? Again, V-scan probe, not very difficult to clean. A clean alcohol wipe can be used after every patient. And touchscreen devices can be covered with cling film. If you have, there are so many instruments now, even for LASIK, for everything, touchscreen devices can be covered with cling film over which we can spray solutions and then keep on removing them regularly after every few patients. For electrophysiology, preferable to use disposable electrodes and clean the wires with alcohol wipes. So that's why I've given a picture of alcohol wipes. Coming to the surgical part, what do we do before surgery? Before washing, as we are already doing surgeries, even during the COVID period, we never stopped doing retina surgeries. Prior to washing, the mask should be worn. Wear N95 masks. To me, because I am a little bit sleep apnea person also, N95 mask is very difficult to me. So I am using 3-ply surgical mask, but I use 2 masks. Like you will see in my pictures also forward. I'll show you the pictures I've shown you earlier also. I use 2 3-ply surgical masks. Shoe covers and goggles and caps must be worn before we enter the OT. So before entering, these things must be worn. Then after washing, waterproof sterile gown, if possible, it is very good. And over that, you can either wear, because we should not be very, very scared. Things are not that bad. We have to be careful that we have covered up ourselves adequately and the patient is also adequately covered up. But we should cover ourselves up only to the point that we are able to do the surgery. Initially, I used the first few days I started doing surgery with those PPE gowns and with the zippers and all almost airtight things and AC not on. It was almost impossible for me to operate. So I switched over to changing my clothes, wearing these clean linen of the OT dress, and then over that preferably a waterproof sterile gown. And touch wood, till date we are all okay. You can see me again wearing goggles. With goggles we can definitely do this surgery. With the microscope, through the microscope I don't feel any problem. And this, you can see the double mask. I am wearing 2 masks. I discard 1 mask after every surgery. Coming to intravitreal injections, very important thing. What was in pre-COVID era? Pre-COVID era, we used to do full OT sepsis, gown, mask and gloves like everybody does. In USA, people used to do even in the OPD, but now they have changed also. Post-COVID era, the patient wears mask. Earlier, the patient never used to wear mask when we used to give injections. Now the surgeon is wearing the mask, N95 mask or a double mask. Only 1 injection is loaded per patient. In a heavy days, the pre-COVID eras, we used to sometimes load because, you know, for 3 or 4 patients, we used to load the injection and keep it separately for separate patient. But these days, we are not following that. We are taking only 1 injection loaded, changing the whole set for the next patient and minimum 10-minute gap between 2 patients so that the OT staff can completely sterilize the area, the OT table and everything. So follow-up of intravitreal injection, because intravitreal injection is a thing which we cannot stop. Even in America, Europe, I have read so many articles. During COVID times also, they were giving these injections because these injections cannot be stopped. Once they stop, there is a high chance of losing the eye. So, but we can stop calling them for follow-ups. A patient who has already undergone 2 or 3 injections intravitreal, we can not call them for the follow-up like we used to do for first 24 to 48 hours. We can wait for a few days, talk to him on phone once a week, and if the patient is fine, he can come when we feel that there is a time for his next injection or when there is some trouble with the patient, if there is a drop in the vision or the patient feels some problem. Coming to vitreoretinal surgery, why is it essential to protect oneself? Like I told in the beginning of my talk, mostly vitreoretinal surgeries are emergency surgeries. It will be very, very difficult to delay. Only those patients we can confidently postpone whom we know are COVID positive, and because government has given the ruling that COVID positive patients can be sent to COVID positive hospitals, so we cannot delay. The duration of surgery is longer. So that is why the contact time principle is very important. Retina cataract surgery, LASIK surgery, 5 minutes, 10 minutes, maximum 15 minutes. But retina surgeons sometimes have to suffer 1 hour, even 2 to 3 hours also, depending on the case. So sometimes the general anesthesia is also required, the point which has not been touched so far. General anesthesia, the anesthetist has to take really special precautions because anesthetist giving GA is the most prone to catch a COVID from a patient who is suffering from one. So GA is also required sometimes during these long surgeries. So we must be very, very careful. Try to finish the surgery safely and as fast as possible. That is why this is not the time to teach or let your interns or residents do your surgeries for you, or even say the end of the surgery when you are giving, say, to suture the conjunctiva. Everything should be done by the same surgeon and the same fast team. Don't rely on people who are not fast. Patient protocols. Patient to wear mask and to be taped. The mask over the patient should be taped, and 5% povidone iodine drops must be put prior to patient coming into the OT. And we are always doing this. We were always practicing this before in the pre-COVID era, and we are still following the same. And when the patient, before we start the surgery, we are doing these betadine drops. And the drapes should be watertight. You can see this plastic drapes, avoid lint drapes. And these are the watertight drapes, along with, you can say, a drainage bag here. All the fluid is going into the drainage bag. Luckily, in the retina surgeries, there is not a lot of aerosol formation like Dr. was showing in his video of the FACO. In our surgeries, there is no aerosol, very minimal if it is so, and I have not found any study. So, but betadine cleaning is a very, very important factor even to reduce the chances of endophthalmitis. So, coming to the surgical techniques, we should try to use valve cannulas as far as possible, prevent fluid spills, especially during the fluid air exchange, because fluid air exchange is one step of the surgery where we can really cause some aerosol formation. Vitrectomy to be preferred over scleral buckling, because scleral buckling, a lot of suturing is to be done. You are coming in contact with a lot of body fluids, and it sometimes takes longer also. So surgery speed to reduce contact time, and extra care of disinfecting surfaces, and no reuse of instrument between two patients. That is very, very important, because we have the tendency sometimes we may use a cutter or we change the cutter, but the tubing is the same. All things are now being changed since the time of the COVID. We don't even reuse the tubings that are coming from the cassettes. Sometimes we were using the cassettes again, but now we don't do it. Now we are changing for every patient, even the vitrectomy cassettes. If they have to be reused, are reused only after doing drying them, doing a proper ETO, and then using the next or the third or fourth day, not the same day. Then roll off 3D vitrectomy is going to increase as technology is coming in. Everything digital, fingerprint machine is not now going to help. Now it is going to be face recognition, or maybe through the mask recognition. Then roll off 3D vitrectomy, because it is a contact-like surgery. You don't have to come close to the patient. There are no, as you can see in this microscope, there are no binoculars. So this surgery is doing sitting back, relaxed with the hands inside the eye. It is like a endoscopic surgery. So 3D surgery, like the ingenuity system of Alcon, they may gain from this COVID era. And even cataract surgeries can be done beautifully through this ingenuity system. I have myself not practically done surgery through this, but I have attended many sessions, practical sessions also, and I have really had a feel of this technology. And I hope that technology will help us. We should try to take as much precautions as possible. And thank you very much for everything. And this is just to share, my daughter and myself, we sometimes make her. This is a chocolate smoothie she makes with me, and like everybody was saying, Dr. was saying, Dr. Kamal was saying, we should relax the time extra we get. We are making, this is my own production with the help of my daughter. So after this, again, my daughter is ready with something, some food is being made, I think some noodles today, and we should enjoy our time, spend some time with the family, and take all the precautions and hope for the best. Thank you very much. Thank you. Over to Dr. J.R., Dr. Piyush.
Thank you, Dr. Neeraj Manchanda, for elaborating how the retinal surgeries are being done. And just a question to the entire group of doctors, like, are you using PPE or providing PPE to all the staff in the OT, or you are basically using the normal gowns and all? Dr. Kamal, like, would you like to share your experience?
Yeah. Individually, yeah. Everybody can tell.
Okay, I'll share something with you, Piyush. When the scare of COVID came in, we went ahead and bought 200 sets of PPE for my OT staff, and only to realize within 3 days of wearing, they said, sir, we cannot survive in this because we are asking them to switch off their conditioners. They can't survive in that. So we've stopped.
But are you not using the air conditioners even in the OT?
No, we switch on the air conditioners in the morning, let the temperature pick up. We do a few surgeries, switch it off, take a gap, then again switch on the air conditioners, UV lights, take a gap, and then again 1 hour break, we start again.
About the AC, sorry, I'm interrupting. About the AC part, a retina surgery in a closed OT is very, very difficult without AC. Not only because you cannot breathe, but the fogging, the humidity control is very, there is a lot of fogging during retina surgery. So,
I know that.
Without AC, will not go. So, we are.
Especially in Delhi, the temperature is almost crossing 42.
So, I say is PPEs are there for anybody to use. Nobody is refrained from using them. But yes, I know within a period of last 10 days, everybody stopped using PPE. They just lying in the store. Anybody wants to use them, he just indents to the central store. It's intended to the doctor.
And how about the usage in Bombay, sir?
No, we are not using PPE.
We are not,
issue.
Only gowns or disposable gowns, like linen gowns.
We had a difficulty that my staff just refused that we will not like to work in the OT without a PP. So we had to, you know, just immediately get in a few, and most of the staff still demand that they want to be in the PP. So sometimes, like it can be, as Dr. Kamal said, a person's choice that what does he or she want, and in this time of COVID, I think we cannot refuse as an employer or as the head of the institution to for any kind of a protective kit. Going down to the next talk, I would like to invite Dr. Piyush Bajaj, who is a very versatile oculoplastic surgeon. He has done his fellowship from Arvind Eye Institute and is working with Healing Touch. And Dr. Piyush Bajaj would be talking about the facial aesthetic, how to approach these patients in this COVID era. Dr. Bajaj, over to you now.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir. Am I audible, sir?
Yes, you are audible. Yeah. Okay.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for the kind welcome. Slide share on.
Yeah, you put your slide share. Your slide share is still not on.
Yes, sir, I'm switching it. Switching it on. Is it visible now, sir?
Yeah.
Yes.
Yes.
Good evening, everyone. Hi. I am Dr. Piyush Bajaj. Being an oculoplasty surgeon, I've been given this task to speak about oculoplasty and facial aesthetic practices, how to be restarted in this COVID times. Just a basic about the reality about this disease. This COVID-19 is a pandemic with a unique transmission that we all know about it. And it has an increased spread among the healthcare workers. Spread has definitely reduced due to this lockdown. As Dr. Kamal Kapoor, sir, has listed it, that we are among the 110th. In 110 days, we have reached about 1 lakh. The global guidelines initially told us only on emergency surgery should be done during this lockdown period, but now since the lockdown has been relaxed, the data will completely change. The COVID-19 data for today was seen as a total 5 million people have been infected globally. But if we look down to the condition that most of the people, 98% are in the milder form and only 2% are into the critical stage. Coming to the COVID testing facilities, the facilities are not actually available to all, but and also not at all mandatory for all surgeries. The reduced surgery time and a proper protective gear can lower down the spread. 10 days, we have reached about 1 lakh. The global guidelines initially told us only emergency surgery should be done during this lockdown period, but now since the lockdown has been relaxed, the data will completely change. The COVID-19 data for today was seen as a total of 5 million people have been infected globally. But if we look down to the condition that most of the people, 98% are in the milder form and only 2% are into the critical stage. That
elective procedure should be avoided.
Coming to the COVID testing facilities, the facilities are not actually available to all, but and also not at all mandatory for all surgeries. The reduced surgery time and a proper protective gear can lower down the spread. 10 days, we have reached about 1 lakh. The global guidelines initially told us only
emergency surgery should be done during this lockdown period, but now since the lockdown has been relaxed, the data will completely change. The COVID-19 data for today was seen as about 5 million people have been infected globally, but if we look around to the condition that most of the people, 98% are in the milder form, and only 2% are into the critical stage. Coming to the COVID testing facilities, the facilities are not actually available to all, but and also not at all mandatory for all surgeries. That reduce surgery time in a protected year can lower down the spread in days. We have reached our contact. The global guidelines initially focused only on emergency surgery should be done during this lockdown period, but now since the lockdown has been relaxed, the data will completely change. The COVID-19 data for today was seen as about 5 million people have been infected globally, but if we see around to the condition that most of the people, 98% are in the milder form, and only 2% are into the critical stage.
Elective procedures should be avoided.
Coming to the COVID testing facilities, the facilities are not actually available to all, but and also not at all mandatory for all surgeries. That reduce surgery time in a protected year can lower down the spread in days. We have reached our contact. The global guidelines initially focused only on emergency surgery should be done during this lockdown period, but now since the lockdown has been relaxed, the data will completely change. The COVID-19 data was today was seen as about 5 million people have been infected globally, but if we see around to the condition that most of the people, 98% are in the milder form, and only 2% are into the critical stage. Elective procedures should be avoided. Coming to the COVID testing facilities, the facilities are not actually available to all, but emergency surgery should be done during this lockdown period, but now since the lockdown has been relaxed, the data will completely change.
Have been given by Oculoplasty Society or the
AOS
not available to all and not feasible for everyone to get it. Can go ahead with the proper full-fledged setups. Coming to not an emergency and be postponed, but there can be few instances when the patient might counseled around before the lockdown, and he wanted before because he was getting married in August and he wanted to go for a pre-wedding shoot now. So he asked me, I need Botox. I advised him Botox. Not just ignorance, but it is the illusion of knowledge. By my mentor, Dr. Usha Kim, she told everyone that it is more than coronavirus is more like the chapter in Mahabharata. Without knowing how to get out of it. And he was without a proper protective gear, without knowing how to come out of it, can lead us into a
available to all and not feasible for every
slowdown can lead to depression, has led to depression and has been reported and has been given
can go ahead with the
and health is our only
setups.
Biggest wealth we should always remember.
Coming
plan a surgery, schedule a surgery,
even more than the surgical procedure.
not an emergency and be postponed. But there can be a few instances when the patient might
Stop because I believe we are running short of time as well.
Yeah, yes, I need Botox.
Dr. Anjani, I believe you can just go on with your talk.
Good evening, everyone. Are my slides visible?
Yes, very well.
So at the outset, I would like to thank the organizers and the esteemed speakers who have covered everything so well and given so many practical tips. What I would be covering is what the lesson we've learned from this COVID-19 pandemic is that we as ophthalmologists can still, despite the lockdown, provide the basic medical services or have a link of contact with our patients through telemedicine. And what we are going to learn in the next 12 to 13 minutes is how to do it better.
Go ahead.
Can go ahead with the and proper health full is our setups. Only biggest always coming
we start this
not an emergency and be postponed, but there can be few instances when the patient
divide our lives into a pre-COVID, a COVID, and a post-COVID era. Are my slides visible? So, in the pre-COVID era, also tele-ophthalmology. So, I would like to thank the organizers and the esteemed speakers who have covered everything so well. And this is how ROP screening was done. A lot of infants were screened and treated, and a lot of blindness was prevented.
Go ahead.
It was also used in glaucoma, also in diabetic screening, especially artificial intelligence was being utilized. And the actual aim of this action actually underwent laser, otherwise would have gone blind or would have had a severe vision loss. And this was also welcomed by patients because patient satisfaction has been reported about 88% to 98%. Use the patient. It is involved in all other liable for litigation. Patient health protection and discharge system.
Send via WhatsApp email the prescription that we issue to the patient. So, possible,
consult is paused. Telemedicine is a vital tool in the present times and the future, both for patients and doctors, when reaching the clinics is is so difficult, and there's so much risk of exposure. And also a lot of our patients are in the elderly age group, but it is still a bane for the patients and doctors if exercised with caution. Thank you.
Sir,
we can straight away go to
Dr. Kuresh Mastipi is a well-known personality in the ophthalmic society, and Dr. Mastipi has held the position of AIUS president in from 2014 to 2015. Has been the president International Society of Manual Small Incision Cataract Surgery from 17 to 19, and president of Cornea Society of India between 2017 to 19. Undoubtedly, Dr. Kuresh Mastipi is a personality which I believe anybody in this era of ophthalmology would recognize blindly for his contribution to the society in terms of his academics and in terms of his experience, who has helped the various ophthalmologists groom up to the present position. Dr. Mastipi has also held the position of President Bombay Ophthalmological Society from 2000 to 2001, and has been the President of Maharashtra Ophthalmological Society between 1995 to 1996.
So President, he has always been the President of almost all the societies.
I believe he has
had the membership of. So much risk of exposure, and also a lot of our patients are in the age group. But it is still a bane for the patients and doctors.
And I would just request you to proceed with your talk, sir.
Thank you, Piyush. Can we share screen now? Yeah, okay. I'll stop share. Thank you. So, luckily for all of us, all good things must come to an end. So, you have finally something called the last speaker. Not going into everything that has been said so far, just answering one question. Rather than the NCT, I have no financial or commercial interest, but I would prefer the eye care economy to which I'm asking the Goldman, because you can easily self-sterilize this because of the heat generated. You can also use an alcohol swab and sterilize it, and the aerosol generated is very minimal because it's a very thin head, no touching the cornea rather than the large puff of air. So disinfectant wipes is one of the ways you can can I have the muted please of the patient in mind? Every patient is a potential COVID patient. So some common strategies for reducing the likelihood is, of course, regular hand washing. So in the morning, you can either wear gloves and change your gloves between patients. But I have a basin and a wash basin among in between cases, I take a break for 5 minutes where I go and wash my hands with soap and water, at least for 20 seconds, washing them as prescribed. Of course, the mask is a given and all the other things that the other speakers had presented. One new thing, relatively new, which was not meant for COVID, but which we are using now for COVID, is the lid wipes. We get lid wipes and lids and sprays available. And just like alcohol sprays and the sanitizers, we can use these as well to clean the parts of the face that you want to touch. You feel a little itching on your forehead, you can use a lid wipe and clean it rather than using your finger. And lid wipes are of two types, those which contain just some saline and alcohol, and those which contain tea tree oil. And there are certain benefits to this. We've used tea tree oil for quite some time now for Demodex. We know that Demodex lives in our eyelashes, so for Demodex to reduce blepharitis, we've been using tea tree oil.
Are relevant the and active they need component to be
is terpenin as well. For all.
So disinfectant wipes is
the tea tree oil. We can't pronounce tea tree oil, so we use different abbreviations.
Can I have
we know that there are different types of Demodex, those which is Demodex follicularis, which is in our hair. Follicles are the Demodex subrenis, which lives in the sebaceous and the meibomian gland. You can identify the blood for purposes of shortage of time. I'm not showing a video of the Demodex crawling all over the hair follicle. So we know about the Demodex and the importance of this. This is where we use this product of the lid wipe.
I go and wash my hands and the spray for 20 seconds. Washing them as the mask is given and all the other things that the other speakers
have. One new thing,
relatively new, which is not meant for COVID, but now for COVID, agent is the lid wipes. We get lid wipes and sprays available.
Dampen the
and just like analyzers, we can use these as well
red eye
to clean
and the use of the demo and the tea tree oil scrub and the eye becomes relatively white just because the lids have been taken care of. We know that poor lid hygiene leads to MGD, associated tear film instability, and therefore a dry eye or an ocular surface disorder. So all these things are all well connected. So this, what does this tea tree oil do? It enhances the lid hygiene. What does it do? It's been raising the cell membrane of the virus.
Also, disinfectant wipes.
Cell membrane deviations. Once the cell membrane is broken, any cell cannot survive. So it's always Demodex factors. Whether it's the Demodex, whether it's bacteria, and now we know that even for viruses, this is not exactly the same. This is a potential as an antiviral agent. I'm not sure. The first video of the first SARS epidemic that had come out somewhere in 2003. The picture that you see is of a leaf. The tobacco leaf and the tobacco mosaic virus, which was attacking the tobacco plants.
We know that poor lead hygiene leads to MGD, associated tear film instability, and therefore various studies that have been done, disorder.
So all these things are all well. And we're finding that now, connected to 2006, what does this tobacco mosaic virus, the herpes simplex virus, and other RNA viruses, and we found that now during the sanitizers. You know that sanitizers do contain alcohol. What if you were to combine it 5 to 10% TTO? This already been experimented on. The beauty of this is that the sanitizer half-life on the skin is very short. But if you add TTO, then it can remain for even 4 hours on the skin. So if you rubbed it on your face, for example, then you get a 4-hour protection. Even if you were to touch your face by mistake, it's unlikely to spread COVID virus. In India at the moment, it's available in two forms as lid wipes and a lid cleanser, sort of a spray mechanism which can be used. also has aloe vera, which is good for the skin, which is available to us. So it can be used both by the doctor himself as well as the patient whenever required. It can supplement our normal hand washing and other hygiene measures that we take. So it can be used as a disinfectant wipe for the eyes, the face, and as I said, whenever you feel the urge to itch, instead of that, just open a wipe and use it on your hands or on the face and even near the orifices of the face. So these are the two current TTO-based products that I said. And there is a move to bring hand sanitizers with TTO as well. It's been submitted to the U.S. Peter Doherty Institute, and a report is awaited pretty soon. We should be getting this as well in the market. I thank you so much for your attention. And to summarize today's session, all of the speakers have talked about staying safe. Don't start an OPD or OP unless you have standard SOPs. And Kamal and others have shared their SOPs and are willing to share their SOPs if you just email them. T3 oil can be a useful adjunct to be used by us as well as the patients as a face and eyelid cleanser, and can be prescribed for the patients as well. TTO-based wipes and eye cleansers are available. So again, I thank you very much, all of you who participated in our meeting and contributed by your questions and by your patient listening. Over to the moderators. And let's have an opinion poll to see how much you enjoyed this session.
Going further, I would just bring out two questions which I would like Dr. Qureshi to answer. It was by Dr. Sunil Narang. He just asked that how practical it would be to provide sterile gowns to all the surgical patients, as it was mentioned. Maybe Dr. Kamal can also contribute in the OT. So Dr. Kamal is raising his hand, so I think he wants to answer it. Please, sir.
Yeah, go ahead, Kamal.
What we've done is we all are using disposable sterile gowns for the surgeons. I have a stock lot of nearly 90 cotton gowns which were lying with me. So what I've done is I just put them into a recycle in the evening. They are all autoclaved and they are packed and for the patients to walk in the operation theater. So what it does for me is I don't want the patient to be carrying in anything external from his surface. So he's wearing shoe covers, he's wearing a cap, and he's wearing a three-layer mask handed to him outside the theater. All I need to give him is an autoclaved sterile gown. So when I say a sterile gown, it's not a disposable sterile gown given to the patient. It's an autoclave sterile gown. And we have, I'm sure we all have ample of them lying in our stores because none of us is using an autoclave gown now. So those gowns are being now brought back into service. So as I mentioned in my conversation, it's about getting to best of whatever you have. So we
not only that, Kamal, it's a very feel-good factor for the patient.
Absolutely.
When he feels half a surgeon when he's made to wear an autoclave sterile gown. And he really feels that we are doing something for him which is out of the ordinary. So even psychologically, it tends to help to have a sterile gown being put. And as Kamal correctly says, all of us have this in stock with us already.
And so the best thing is we give them a fresh cap, we give them a shoe cover, we give them a mask. So as you said, the experience of the patient is, now here is an organization which is taking care of me and themselves.
So just a question to the panelists, like, what do you feel that is it really necessary or we can even do with the normal washed gowns which are not autoclaved?
Can I say something?
Dr. Kumar.
This is what I'm doing is, I don't know what the panel thinks on this, is I have a lot of these disposable
gowns. Yes, Kumar.
I ETO them. And then wear them. Anything wrong in that?
Nothing at all. Kumar, whatever works for you.
Actually, I want to put in a point that all these PPE kits, etc., the sterility is not as important. They have to be clean. And once they are cleaned with soap and water disinfects the hand, the face and everything. So once they are cleaned with soap and water, sterility is not the main issue. It has to be clean. And when it is done in soap and water, it is fine because we are not doing operating through the gown or anything. So I think it should be a washed gown. Newly washed gown should be as good as a autoclave. I don't think so is really required.
I agree with you, Neeraj. I just like to add a point. I agree with you 100%. But I don't know, 4 days post-op, I come to know that there was a patient who was COVID positive. And the gown has gone for washing to the laundry So it's just to for the reassurance of my team. Basically, it's more for my team that they know even the patient walks in with a sterile gown. So
if your patient was COVID positive and you have given him a sterile gown, it goes to the laundry, it would still have that infection load, whether it was pre-autoclaved or not. How much difference will it cause? The laundry person would be exposed equally if it was autoclaved or it was not autoclaved.
Definitely.
No, sweet, that's what I'm saying. That is what I'm saying.
I want to point out that I would like to point out that we need to give those SOPs which are practically more user friendly.
Definitely.
Instead of increasing the load of the autoclave every time, like you are asking somebody to autoclave all the gowns, and you are increasing the load of the autoclave, the electricity with all the commercial things going so high, I think if you are giving a pretty well-washed gown, which is you well-washed in your laundry, would serve the purpose very good.
I understand, Piyush, but in case you heard my talk, it was about the practices I do. I'll understand, but I probably you're one of those lucky ones who's got 50, 60 surgeries happening every day, so there's a gown for you. At least in my practice, I don't have that kind of load. So anybody who's doing a lot of number of surgeries every day, yes, the gown load could be a trouble. Maybe you are having 50, 60, 70, 80 surgeries a day.
I am putting a question of Dr. Sunil Narang, actually, sir. 60, 60 surgeries,
we are doing 20, 30 surgeries a day. That's it.
Yeah, my whole idea is that let us put the houses there to give their consensus. Everybody is following their own SOPs. So, just the consensus, as Dr. Qureshi said,
that
the take-home message to the public should be such that let us give us what is really practical and useful for everybody.
I agree with you.
Go ahead.
And as long as you dry the gowns in the sunlight where the UVC is good, you know, 222 nanometers to anything between 222 to 250 is good enough to kill the virus in 30 minutes, that also works good enough.
Even soap and water is good enough. Good quality soap, and not to share the gowns with any. Absolutely. One patient should not share the gown with the other patient, and how to dispose of those gowns. Otherwise, the only alternative is to throw the gown after every patient, which is again very impractical.
Second question by the same person was Dr. Sunil Narang. He had asked that if we put a micropore tape on the mask of the patient, that would actually make the patient feel very suffocated or very claustrophobic. So what is the practice which the surgeons out over here are being following? Dr. Kumar would like to answer.
So I've tried this, you know, I've just started surgery recently. I did a few last week and today. If you put a mask, even when you're cleaning with betadine, patients are not very happy. And they are not used to wearing it. Whatever you try to say, you pull the mask down, you clean the whole eye with betadine, they try to pull the mask down. So this is a struggle I was finding today with one of the patients. So they're normally trying to pull it down below the nose because then they feel that, okay, now they can breathe. So we tell them that we try to give them from a normal mask that they are wearing, we give them an autoclave mask which we have in our center to wear, and we don't mind if they go below because then our drape goes above the nose. So I'm just trying to protect myself that way. And anyway, our cataract surgery doesn't take more than a few minutes. So tell them that this is one thing. Why I talked about ETO gowns that I give to the patient, because we have lots of gowns which are disposable. I ETO them, and ETO is not very expensive. It's only about 75 rupees for a can, and you can at one time ETO 6-7 gowns. So I just thought it a little safer, more practical, and not very expensive. What I thought Kamal was doing was expensive because your electricity bill will go up quite a bit. So I was just trying to save on that side and putting ETO gowns and which are sterile, which we think are sterile and which is good enough for the patient to wear and go. So I do make them wear a mask down. I cover the rest of the eyes. Only this part is exposed, as we all do during our surgery. And that's how I'm taking care.
And we can use those watertight drapes. Watertight drapes are very important. Because retina surgery, we are doing that.
Yeah. I believe in this COVID era, everybody is trying to experiment and make himself more safe and their patients more safe. And making the looking into the patient's comfort as well. I also tried a trick into it where we just connected an oxygen cylinder to a small rise tube which was cut from the front, and we just put it inside the mask of the patient so that it acts like an oxygen tent and the patient doesn't feel that claustrophobic in this. So basically, I would say just trying a few tricks.
How much does that rise tube cost per patient?
Sir, it does cost, but I didn't look into the cost. What not we do is we keep cutting it, and not for all, whosoever feels claustrophobic. But just for the safety sake, I am being particular that I don't allow the patient to put down the mask below the nose because of the fear within us also that, you know, the aerosols from the patient's nose are damn more contagious than the aerosols which are arising from the phaco probe at the wound juncture.
Yes.
So this is a very interesting question. In setups where phaco tips and few other instruments are continued for consecutive cases, any suggestions how we should space our surgeries now?
They have Thomas. To stop. My answer is they have to stop and they have to change.
Can I answer? Exactly.
In our surgeries also, like I told.
We cannot in this era go on using the same tips for all the patients. It's impossible now.
Okay.
Dr. Kamal.
See, what I'll do is earlier probably max what we were using a tip was for maybe two patients. And by the time you finish that, then the next trolley would be ready. But I agree with what Piyush said is in this era, I don't think we should be doing that. What a average practitioner should probably now invest in is maybe right now or in the future is have more handpieces and not more many machines. Have more handpieces and have extra. I'm not saying make a complete new set, but the most frequently used instruments in your set are maybe three or four. Have repeated numbers of those and have maybe let's have two or three basic sets. And the number of instruments you use a lot, keep a ratio of them more, have more handpieces, have one machine, because I don't think right now we can actually practice one tip, one handpiece, one instrument, doing five surgeries and then changing for the next one. Those times are gone now.
Actually, what we are practicing at our center is that we are placing the surgeries in the whole day. Like if we have 9 hours of working, in one particular hour, we are just calling in three patients, and wonderful. we are trying to just autoclave the instruments in between. That, as Dr. Kamal rightly pointed out, in a flash autoclave, the set goes inside, and in that time, particularly the OT is disinfected by the time the next patient is called in. And once the next patient is ready, we have a fresh set and fresh everything placed for the patient over there.
Anything, Dr. Kuresh, your comments?
I am basically shifting more to SICS now. And so therefore the phaco, but I agree with all of you that the era of using the same phaco tip is gone. And the faster everyone realizes it, the better it is. There is no shortcut. Absolutely.
Kumar, your opinion?
You have to change like what you said. Only problem is this is going to really limit our number of cases in all the centers. I mean,
absolutely.
Right now.
Which it should, which is a good thing in the first 6 months, I would say, that you're starting. Please limit the number of cases and have gaps of 20 minutes. The 20 minutes is not for time pass, but the 20 minutes between cases is hugely important to make your theater sterile again and COVID-free. Yeah, so... therefore, there is no point in doing 30, 40 cases in one half a day session just because you can.
I wish your words come true.
Yeah. We'll be doing 30, 40 cases in the whole day and take.
I think we need to wind up now. Can we have the...
hello, everyone. Here is a small survey.
Go ahead, Parul.
Thank you, sir. So, everyone should go to www.menti.com and the system will ask you the code. The code is 87353. I'm repeating. Everyone should go to www.menti.com and the system will ask you the code. The code is 87353. I will wait for 2 minutes so that everyone can enter in our survey.
I think it was a great interactive session. By the time people are getting ready, I'm sure what I would do is probably before or after we go for the poll, I would want all the speakers to summarize their talk in 3 points. What would be the carry-home points they would want the audience to go back home with? 3 or 4 points of their talk. That will really sum it up into a little tablet of compressed juice. So by the time the poll is going on, I would request all the speakers to just compress in their head 3 points they want the audience to go back to.
So let's begin with our survey. So first question is, do you think the worst of COVID-19 is over? I'm getting responses. Let's wait a few more minutes. And as Dr. Kapoor said that no, approx 80% of our participants think that the worst of COVID-19 is not over. So let's move to the next question. Did this webinar answer your unanswered questions? I can see the responses coming in. And it is good to hear that 67% of our participants got their answers. Let's move
Arul,
to the next
I'd just
question.
Like to add one thing. I'd just like to add one thing here.
Yeah, ma'am.
I was lucky to be born to a very great man, my father. So he always used to tell me, son, always have an unanswered question. And he used to tell me, always judge a man by not the answers he gives, but by the questions he asks. That the audience still have unanswered questions, I think we have a great audience.
33%.
Let's move to the next question. The last question. Do you think that eyelid and face hygiene are needed daily in the current COVID scenario? I'm getting responses. And yes, we agree too that eyelid and face hygiene is important than ever before. Thank you so much for attending our survey, and I hope you find it interesting as we did it. Thank you so much.
So you can log us off, Parul, from the live, then we all speakers can have a chat.
Yes. You don't want to do the summary of 3 points, Kamal?
Yes, of course. But before, I'm just telling you, once we do that, then we can log off and have a discussion. So let's start with, I think I was the first one. 3 carry-home points which I would tell the audience, all of my friends, is that we all know the reality of COVID. It is here. It will go wherever it will go. So we need to come back to our normal lives. Whatever normal we can make out of the present situation, that's one. Number two is we need to have a team who believes that yes, they can be served safe and yet deliver to the society at large. And number three, most important, is we need to have our patients actually believe that we are standing for them, and we all this extra paraphernalia, infrastructure, costing we are doing is for their and our safety. Once these three things go in a loop or they are synced, I think we'll be back in action. So that's my 3 carry-home points. We need to believe that we need to do whatever we need to do. Our team needs to believe that, yes, it is true that we can be still safe and yet work normally. And the patients can need to believe that, yes, we're taking all the care for them. And then things will start coming back to normal. Dr. Neeraj, your 3 carry-home points you want the audience to go back with.
I have basically one carry-on point, and that is that be safe, take all the precautions, don't worry even if it is a long surgery. All doctors are taking precautions. We will take precautions for the patients. It may involve little more expenditure, but everybody wants to remain safe. So please, I will request the patients also, from their side also, they should maintain a good hygiene. Before entering the clinic, they should see that they are all in good health and they are doing a proper hygiene. And we at the clinic are definitely doing all these things for them. And remember, like my, I have got two drivers with me. One of the drivers was staying home during all this period. And the other driver was coming every day to me. So I told the driver that this is not the time for you to stay home. This is the safest period. Nobody's on the roads. And today when he came back, today he has come back after 1.5 months. He said, sir, you were right. 1.5 months back, you said that was a safe time to come. The times are going to remain same. We have to be in the new normal. And this new normal may not change for a long, long time. So let us be very, very careful, do our hygiene things and leave the rest to the doctors and be assured. The patient should be assured that the doctors and the hospitals are the safest place to be because we are taking maximum precautions. You going to a restaurant or going to a roadside dhaba, people, those places are not as safe as we are. So patients should understand that because especially for big hospital like Gangaram Hospital has 3 branches and people are scared to come to the big hospital because the other 2 smaller branches are taking care of COVID patients. So I tell my patients, don't be scared to come to the big hospital. We are taking the maximum precautions. Nobody is taking such precautions. The sabji wala, the fruit wala, the stationery store, the roadside street hawker, they are not taking precautions. You should be more careful there also rather than with us. We are definitely taking good precautions with whatever, however we can. Thank you very much.
Dr. Kuresh, your carry-on points?
My carry-on point is actually not 3, but just 1. Have the courage to start for those who have not started. Some point you have to start. Have the courage to start. As Kamal said, if you have faith in yourself and your team and you're following the SOP, then the patients will have faith in you and the practice, I am sure, will build up to near pre-COVID era before the year is over. Thank you.
Absolutely true. Kumar, your point.
First of all, thank you all for giving this opportunity. I have some take-home messages. One is, we have to make sure that our staff has faith in us that we are looking after them. That's what Kamal pointed out, and it's just a spelling that yes, we have to make sure they are happy. Two, we have to make sure that our patients are sure that we are looking after them.
Absolutely.
If we do things reasonably well, the story will then begin. If we fail anywhere, the whole story is going to collapse. As far as the technique of FACO, I thought the aerosol thing, putting methyl cellulose in incision and taking care of the aerosol solved all the confusion. And I think as far as the PPE is concerned, all of you know to wear a PPE is like a sauna. And you don't need to go to sauna, we all will lose a lot of weight, which is
absolutely
also a side effect. But I think that this is enough that what we are doing is pretty good. Patients will have faith. They will ultimately come. Although it's an elective procedure, they will ultimately get it done. So I think this is a fantastic webinar. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Dr. Anjani, your carry-on points you want the audience to go back with?
So the carry-on points from my talk, I would say, is that telemedicine, especially in these times, is quite an important tool. The only caveat is that we should be very well informed of what to do and what not to do. So I would urge the viewers to actually go through the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare guidelines. And if we stick to that and trust our clinical judgment, I think telemedicine can be used as quite a good tool.
And I think what they can do is they can use your presentation as a back reference. It actually is the actual spine of the whole basics of teleophthalmology. I just like to add to the audience benefit is that we at SharpSight, I have been practicing teleophthalmology for the last 2 years. I've developed my own apps within the system. And it really eases the patient. We are able to map the patient's Amsler grid. We are able to map their vision loss, their vision. So my app informs me the moment my patient drops his vision. We inform him to come for a PCO, for a YAG, or for a diabetic retinopathy screening. So we've been doing these for a long time. But now since it's officially on, I think we all need to move on to this platform. Of course, with under the caveats of the present legal infrastructure. Siddharth, back to you. I think Piyush, we left Piyush. Piyush, your carry-on points.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for the opportunity, sir. My basic carry-on points, everyone has told the same thing that we should protect ourselves, our patients and everything. But the main thing should be like we should stay calm right now, stay protected, safe, and plan our surgeries and procedures accordingly. And the right time will come to hit back. Definitely the right time will come someday when the working procedures and everything will be normal.
I'd just like to add one thing to what you said, Piyush. Right time will not come. we will have to create it.
Yes, sir.
Otherwise, if left to the public and the news media, this thing is going on for a long time. We will need to break the shackles under the right protocols, scientific studies and scientific processes. We need to go out there in the public and demonstrate that we are safe. It's safe to get back to your normal life. Because the media will not let it rest. That's their bread and butter. But for their bread and butter, are we going to let our bread and butter go out of the box?
No.
I won't agree there.
Siddharth, it's all yours.
No, thank you very much.
Back to you. Back to you, Siddharth.
Thanks a lot for everyone for a wonderful webinar. And I think it has very well been viewed across country and also globally in the many other places. People are viewing it with the data that I have. So I must first of all congratulate every one of you for really giving a wonderful presentations. It was very, very insightful. And I'm sure that, you know, the kind of enthusiasm this panel has shown today of managing COVID situation is great. They've got a brilliant ideas. They got a good understanding. And I think as a whole, we should be very, very confident that we would manage COVID situation effectively. On behalf of Wayfarm India, I once again thank you very much for your participation, time, and sharing your views. On behalf of my company, I can certainly assure you that Wayfarm would always be there for any of your initiative, academic initiative in the future, and we'll continue to support that. At the same time, whatever we can contribute by bringing some innovation to India, by aligning with some of the foreign companies in India and bringing some good ideas, we are very open. So thank you very much for really making this webinar a great success, and I really appreciate and thank you.
Siddharth, just one point before you close off. Modi ji said, be vocal, be local. No foreign collaboration now.
No, because at many times you need an ideas which are not there. We are suddenly trying to build these products in India. And today, you know, the kind of eyelid segment, that eyelid hygiene, you know, it was not been discussed much in India. So we are the first company to start initiating on the eyelid hygiene. And there are interesting ideas coming up. Dr. Maskati has already spoken about it, eyelid wipes and eyelid cleanser. We have an ideas to bringing you the eyelid sprays, which will make it very comfortable that any given time you just spray it. And these are very good formulations, which can give you a good protection for a longer period of time. So especially in pre-post-op conditions at the same time, we have many other situations like blepharitis, MGD, dry eye, and all you find them very useful. The products are available, Oculif eyelid wipes and Oculif cleansers now freely. And I'm sure that you'll be experiencing them.
Thank you. Thank you all.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Are we off?